5,600 minutes, 525,000 moments so deep, 525,600 minutes. How do you measure a year? In daylights, in sunsets, in midnights, in cups of coffee, in inches, in miles, in laughter, in strife. 525,600 minutes. How do you measure a year in the life? How about love? Oh, how about love? Ooh, how about love? Measuring love. Seasons of minutes, 525,000 journeys to play, 525,600 minutes. How do you measure the life of a woman or a man? In truths that she learned, or in times that he cried? In bridges he burned, or the way that she died. It's time now to sing out, though the story never ends. Let's celebrate, remember a year in the life of friends. Remember the
my friends, here we are today together, another day to measure in love, to be love together in community. Welcome. I'm your worship pastor, Heather Lynn. As we gather together in this space, we invite you to share this live stream. Invite a few folks to join you in the comment thread. Greet one another. Let us know you're here so that we can say hello and greet you. And yeah, if you know this song, certainly feel free to sing along. When you try your best, but you don't succeed. Get what you want, but not what you need. When you feel so tired, but you can't sleep. Stuck in reverse. And the tears come streaming down your face. Something you can't replace. When you love someone but it goes to waste. to fix you. High up above or down below, when you're too in love to let it go. But if you never try, you'll never know just what you're worth. Night's will guide you home and ignite your bones, and I will try to fix you.
Thanks, Heather Lynn. I love Coldplay. I love Chris Martin.
Oh, it's such a beautiful song, isn't it? And how we want to show up for each other, not necessarily to fix each other. You know, the language is what it is, but at least to be present to one another in our healing. So,
you know, I read something about that song, that Chris Martin wrote it to his then wife, Gwyneth Paltrow, after Gwyneth Paltrow's father passed away.
Wrote it in a time of grief. Yeah, that's beautiful.
That's right.
I didn't know that, so thanks for sharing that.
Sure, yeah, of course. Hey, hi, everyone. My name is John. I'm one of the pastors here at Left Hand Church. My pronouns are he, him, and his. I want to welcome everyone to our service. Whether this is the first time you've ever stumbled upon us, or whether you stumbled into a church building 3 years ago for our very first service, I want to welcome you. You're our guest here, and it's great to be with you. Please like and share the video if you can, so we can get the message about Left Hand Church out to as many people as we can. Today is a milestone day, because today is exactly 1 year after our last in-person service. So 365 days ago, we had our last sort of service together in community with each other. I think we all feel that loss pretty acutely. I know I do. I know that our co-pastors do. The good news is I know we're going to be back in the building together very, very soon. So look out for some news on that in the not too distant future. But I do think that there's been a loss of normalcy for a lot of us. But I have to say that this past weekend for me was great. The weather here in Colorado has been phenomenal. It was 70 degrees today. It was almost 70 degrees yesterday. It's almost going to be 70 degrees tomorrow. My wife Kate and I went for a walk today, and we were out and we saw everyone out walking their dogs, riding their bikes. It was almost like old times. It was sort of that day of what does the first day of spring look like? And you can sort of see there's a light at the end of the tunnel here. And my daughter had a soccer tournament this weekend. And so she got to go do the thing that she loves to do, maybe more than anything. And so for her, it was a joyous return to a little bit of normalcy. Now, of course, we couldn't watch her tournament. We had to, the parents had to drop the kids off and then come back an hour and a half and pick the kids up and say, so how did the games go? But at least they got to play. And so it's been a special weekend. And then I know it's going to be an even specialer weekend because today actually is sort of the pregame to the Super Bowl tonight that my wife at least has been telling me about, which is Oprah's interview with Harry and Meghan. So that's a big deal at my house. And it reminds me of what's the similarity between the British royal family and yeast. And the similarity is they're both inbred. But having a sense of normalcy, in this time period is a blessing because we haven't had a lot of normalcy. We hope that our church and that this service has maybe been a bit of normalcy for you every week over the past year and going forward. That's something that we take pretty seriously and that we're attuned toward. So thanks for joining us. We hope that this gives you some light in your week at the end of a weekend as you start your week. Another thing that gives a little bit of normalcy each week is we say our ethos every single week at this church. It goes like this. Married, divorced, or single here, it's one family that mingles here. Conservative or liberal here, we've all got to give a little here. Big or small here, there's room for us all here. Doubt or believe here, we all can receive here. LGBTQ or straight here, there is no hate here. Woman, non-binary or man here, everyone can here. Whatever your race here, for all of us, grace here. In imitation of the ridiculous love Almighty God has for each of us and all of us, let us live and love without labels. Amen.
Amen. Friends, as we sing this song together, let's open up our hearts to receive whatever Spirit may be speaking to us today, however she may be moving from our heads to our hearts, changing us, healing us, restoring us, meeting us in all of the ways that we are missing normalcy and perhaps even grieving in the midst of this. Let's open ourselves to the work of divine love in us. Yes, I want to give you permission wherever you are to clap your hands, to dance, to sing with boldness. All right. I open up to you. This love that makes me new. Oh, may my heart receive this love that carries me from the head to the heart. You take me on a journey of letting go and getting lost in you. Open wide, I will receive your light. You give me faith like a child. In you my heart runs wild. Oh, there's no shame in looking like a fool when I give you what I can't keep and take a hold of you.
take me on a journey of letting go and getting lost in you. From the head to the heart, you take me on a journey of letting go and getting lost in you. There's no shame in looking like a fool when I give you what I can't keep and take a hold of you. There's no shame in looking like a fool when I give you what I can't keep and take a hold of you.
The scandal of the gospel turns conventional wisdom on its head. Love as liberation all the way to the end, my friends. This claim left the creator of all life criminalized and crucified, a loser in the game of power and profit. The cross declared God a failure, an embarrassment, a disgrace. The empire flexed its muscles and declared victory, but love did not recoil nor retreat. Love persisted. Love multiplied. When the empire crumbled, it was love that remained. Still today, love rises before evil in resistance. This is the power of God, the foolishness of our faith. Let's sing together this gorgeous old hymn. Lord, whose love in humble service. Lord, whose love in humble service bore the weight of human need, who upon the cross forsaken worked your mercy's perfect deed. We, your servants, bring the worship, not a voice alone, but heart, consecrating to your purpose every gift which you impart. Still your children wander homeless, still the hungry cry for bread, still the captives long for freedom, still in grief we mourn our dead. As you, Lord, in deep compassion healed the sick and freed the soul, by your Spirit send your power to our world to make it whole. As we worship, grant us vision till your love's revealing light. In its height and depth and greatness dawns upon our quickened sight, making known the needs and burdens your compassion bids us bear, stirring us to ardent service, your abundant life to share. Amen. Peace to you and yours, friends. Let's share the peace of Christ with one another in the comments. Share some virtual hugs if you'd like. And once again, share this live stream if you are moved to do so. Every week we have a peace question to get to know one another a little bit better. So I was wondering, y'all, how has love taken you by surprise? This could be small ways, Paula. It could be big ways. It could be just surprising ways. How has love taken you by surprise? Maybe shown up unexpectedly when you didn't know it was going to.
I think the most substantive time in my life is actually the end of my first TED Talk. It's when my father expressed his love for me after my transition. I didn't see that coming.
Wow.
I should have, given his character. But I also knew that there were forces being exerted upon him to reject me.
Yeah.
Forces that he usually bowed down to. And the fact that he didn't in this case, but showed a complete unselfish love, I'll always be grateful for that.
He let love overcome those other forces. Christy says, the love of this church took me by surprise for real after like a minute. So that's awesome. I'm so grateful for the ways that love shows up and how we embody love together in this community. And I know that you'll be teaching more about that in your sermon. So I'm looking forward to hearing it. And let's, friends, keep our comments, please, during the sermon. Let's please keep our comments relative to the conversation of the sermon. So we certainly can be in dialogue with us, with the words that Paula has to share with us. And let's just focus on that. So thanks a bunch.
We do love to hear from you during a service. We think it's absolutely wonderful. And we want to hear everything going on in your life, both before and after the sermon time, but during the sermon time, we feel like it's a good time to focus in on what it is we're talking about. And we're in our third week of our four-week series. The people of Israel had been enslaved in Egypt for 430 years. 430 years, and then God says, I want you to have a party. I want you to have a feast. I want each of you in your homes to kill the lamb that you have, to eat it, and have a feast. You can just see the people of Israel saying, you know, we're kind of enslaved, and lambs are not easy to come by, and we don't really see a reason for a feast, but they're accustomed to obeying God. And then they discovered the reason. God said, when you are done, you are to take the blood of that lamb and put it on your doorframe, because during the night, the angel of death will be passing over this land and will be taking the firstborn son from every household. But if you have the blood of a lamb on your doorframe, you will be spared and your child will live. Well, certainly to the people of Egypt, there was nothing more important than a firstborn son. A Pharaoh was always concerned about his legacy and his future until he had a firstborn son, because until he had a son, there was no guarantee that that line would continue. And throughout that culture, nothing was more important than a firstborn son. So the people of Israel obeyed, and they put the blood of the lamb in the door frame. And the angel of death passed over, that's where we get the word Passover, and saved their sons, while the rest of the firstborn sons were lost. With that, Pharaoh finally was ready to allow the people of Israel to leave, and Moses led them away across the Red Sea and into the Sinai Peninsula, where for 40 years they were in the desert. Moses received a message of 10 commandments from God atop Mount Sinai, added 603 additional ones to it, 613 laws, many of them not unlike other laws you saw from other lands of the Middle East at the time, but some of them quite different. Laws designed to make Israel a nation different from others, a nation focused on the oppressed, not becoming oppressors, a nation focused on the poor, the lost, orphans, children, widows, those who do not have privilege, all of those struggling, God wanted the nation of Israel to care deeply for those people and was confident they would, given the fact that they had been the oppressed for 430 years. And indeed they did. They became a strong, successful nation. And finally, David was their king, and they became known throughout the known world as a great nation that cared deeply for their own citizens and for others, being concerned for immigrants, the homeless, those who are without hope, bringing life to those who did not have opportunity for it. And then his own son was appointed king. The second son, from his marriage to Bathsheba, Solomon was his name. He was a wise young man, and for a period of time, he too reigned with great justice, Hebrew justice, tzedakah, giving the people what God wanted them to have, grace and mercy and love for all. But then, as so often happens with those in power, the lure of power became too great. And Solomon built a great, beautiful temple, but he built it with slave labor. He built three beautiful cities, but they were in fact military installations designed for war. He bought chariots and horses, not for any defensive purposes, but to sell them at a profit, to profit from war. And they no longer began to care for the oppressed, for the widows, for the orphans, for the children, for those who were less fortunate, for those who were not privileged. They began to care only about the 1%, and the prophets showed up and said, this is not what God asked of Israel. God asks so much more of you. And Israel began to become a shell of its former self, divided into two kingdoms, one with 10 tribes, one with 2 tribes. The kings got worse and worse and worse, and the prophets got stronger and stronger in their words, and still the people of Israel did not want to listen. The oppressed had become the oppressors. Those with no power had become the power hungry. And eventually, after this time of triumph in Jerusalem, Israel was again enslaved, this time by the Babylonians. John will talk about that next week. So this great exodus, this great plan that put an end to 430 years of enslavement, that came when God passed over the land, protected their people, led them through the Red Sea and across the Sinai Peninsula, led them into the Promised Land. This great, beautiful exodus was for naught. They did not become the nation God wanted them to be, a nation concerned for the oppressed, because God's always been on the side of the oppressed. God's always been on the side of the lost. God's always been on the side of the loser. God has always been on the side of the suffering of those in pain, of the widows, the children, the orphans. God has always been on the side of those in tears. And though the Exodus was lost, there would be a new Exodus. Another lamb. This time, God's own son would come to earth to show them a different way of living. You know, we talk all the time here about two reasons that Jesus came to earth. We say that Jesus came to earth to show solidarity with us in our suffering, to be able to say to us that suffering is not the final word. Resurrection is the final word. It's an important lesson we learn from Jesus' time on earth, and particularly from his resurrection. Jesus also came to show us what it is to be truly and fully human, to show us how to live. But then Jesus also came as the lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. Now I see you're getting that sideways look, kind of like a dog, you know, because you're saying, wait a minute, this church has been here like weekly, 3 years, this week. Haven't you told us over and over again that God loves us just as we are? Haven't you told us that God loves us and will take us to heaven regardless of how we behave, no changes demanded? Haven't you told us that God does not hate our sin so much, that God did not have to punish our sin by sending us to hell, and that we needed someone to pay the sacrifice for us? Haven't you told us that Jesus didn't need to be the sacrificial lamb? That kind of sacrificial lamb? Yes, it's exactly what I've told you. Jesus was not a sacrificial lamb to cause God to turn God's wrath away from us so we wouldn't go to hell. Jesus was the sacrificial lamb who came to show us we were on the wrong path. To show us that to be a follower of God is not about power. It's not about oppression. It's not about getting your way. It's not about lording it over others. It's not about who's in charge. It's about the last being the first and the first being the last. It's about shedding tears for the lives of the oppressed, for the children, for the orphans, for the widows, for those who do not have privilege, for those whose days are filled with tears. It's feeling empathy with them. It's identifying with them. It is loving them. The message was not well received. The message is never well received. When you bring the message that life is not about power, life is about service, life is about caring for the poor, that is a message that often gets you killed. And so it did with Jesus. Once again, a sacrificial lamb slain for the sins of the world. How was his death for the sins of the world? It was to show us a better way. 10th chapter, the Gospel of Luke, 24th verse. A bunch of attorneys show up. They have a question for Jesus. What must I do to gain eternal life? Jesus said, well, you're attorneys. What's written in the law? How do you read it? They said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as your own self. Jesus said, yep, do that, and you'll live. But now, pressing his luck, one of the lawyers said, who is my neighbor? Jesus told a story in reply. He said, this guy was headed down the mountain from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he got to this desolate place where there was nothing but burned out cars and stray engine blocks, and he was mugged and left for dead. And a priest came by, but he had pressed for time, and a Levite came by, but he had a budget to balance, and the poor guy by the side of the road was not having a real good day. But then a Samaritan came by, who understood something about pain and suffering and oppression in a way that priest and the Levite did not understand, and he had compassion on the man. And he bandaged his wounds, risking COVID. And he put him on his donkey, risking a lawsuit should he fall off. And he paid for his medical care without any concern for compensation. And Jesus said, now that's my idea of a neighbor. That's what it means to love your neighbor. So I flew home yesterday, and I got on the plane, and there was a woman seated in front of me who had an attitude, not a good attitude either. She got on the plane huffing and puffing about something that had happened in the jetway, and then sitting in the first row, she realized there was no place overhead to put her bags, and so she was huffing and puffing about that. Well, you should have a place for bags overhead. And when a man in the aisle across from her, who also had no place, put his bags in the overhead where she was planning to put hers, then she had something to say about him too. And she was muttering under her breath as she finally put her bags above me. I was sitting in the second row. I thought, wow, what entitlement, what privilege this woman has. And I judged her. The flight takes off. It's a couple hours long. I have time to work on my sermon that I'm preaching the next night, to start memorizing it. It talks about loving your neighbor. She's talking to her daughter. It's annoying to me because I'm trying to work on my sermon, and she's talking to her daughter somewhat loudly. They'd been to some kind of a family affair, and the daughter was concerned that her mother might somehow abandon her. The mother was aghast that the daughter had felt that way. and said, "Oh, you know, I'm just like your father. Neither one of us would ever leave you. Nothing means as much to us as you." The daughter was satisfied, and she started chatting as nine-year-olds do, telling one of those interminable stories that never, ever ends. You think you'll be retired before the story ends? Yeah, you've been there. She just talks and talks, and the mother, instead of just humoring her, listened carefully to the entire story. Quick to judge. I'm often quick to judge. Flight lands. I hopped up, got her bag, and put it down on the floor. I'm tall, and so it's easier for me to get it back down. She profusely thanked me, as did her daughter, and then genuinely thanked me again a couple minutes later, as did her daughter. Love your neighbor as you love your own self. 19th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. A wealthy young man comes to Jesus, says, "What must I do to gain eternal life?" Jesus says, "Keep the law." He illustrates with a few choice offerings from the Ten Commandments and then adds another phrase to it. He says, "You need to love your neighbor as you love your own self." I don't know that the young man really understood how difficult that was going to be, to love your own self. Self-love is hard work. You know, I used to lead a seminar in which I would ask people to take 60 seconds and write on a piece of paper everything they could think of that was wrong about themselves. People wrote and wrote as fast as they could, put as many things down on the paper as they possibly could. When the minute was up, they wanted more time. Then I would say, "You have another 60 seconds to write everything you can think of that is right about you." They'd stare at the paper for 5 or 10 seconds, half-heartedly write down a word or two, put their pencils down, look at their watches, start daydreaming. All of us, unless we're narcissists, have a tendency to see everything we've done wrong. We take those early lessons in so well, and not the things we've done right. We need people in our lives who will tell us what's right about us. It's important for our own sense of self. It's important if we are to ever answer the call of God. You cannot answer the call of God if you do not know what's right about yourself. Where God calls you is where the world's deep hunger meets your deep gladness. You don't know your deep gladness if you don't know what you love. What causes you to lose track of time? You love it so much. What causes other people to affirm you for that which you love so much, to tell you what's right about you? That's how we discover our calling, not by trying to fix what's wrong with us, but by capitalizing on what's right with us. And you cannot do that. You cannot answer the call of God if you do not have people in your life telling you what's right about you. It's part of self-love. Of course, you also can't love yourself if you don't bring people into your life who will tell you what's wrong with you. I have 4 people who I allow to tell me anytime what's wrong with me. 2 of them are members of this church. But you know what? All 4 of them also tell me what's right about me. You shouldn't really be listening to people tell you what's wrong about you if they're not also the ones telling you what's right about you. Because if they see what's good about you, then that means they have the balance to see your flaws in perspective. And they'll help you to see those blind spots. They'll help you to accept the things you cannot change, find the courage to change the things you can. And they are the ones who give you the wisdom to know the difference. You cannot love others if you cannot love yourself. You cannot love yourself if you do not have people telling you what's right about you and what you need to work on. We don't know if the young man decided to follow Jesus or not. If he really understood how difficult it is to love yourself, he might have just focused on his wealth instead. Then we come to the last time, the one that got him killed. The last day Jesus is speaking to the crowds at large. He's asked which of the laws are the greatest. They're trying to catch him and saying something that would allow them to see him dead, see him killed. They don't like the message he's bringing, that God loves everyone just as they are. And he says that there are, in fact, just three that matter. Loving God, loving neighbor, and loving self. And there's dead silence, because it's not the answer they want. And from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions, because from that day on, they knew they would exact revenge for saying such a thing. They would have blood. Jesus knew it. He met with his disciples. It was the Passover, the annual celebration of the feast, of the night that the angel of death had passed over the homes of the people of Israel. Jesus knew he would be the sacrificial lamb, not to take care of our sins so we don't go to hell, but the sacrificial lamb who brought the message that love wins. He told the disciples, this body will be broken for you. I've been willing to pay the price to bring this message, to care for the oppressed, the poor, the lost, those who do not have privilege, to care for the widows, the orphans, the children, those whose days are filled with tears. I'm willing to bring the message that we should always be loving those people first, caring for those people first, and my body will be broken for it, and my blood will be shed for it. And as you eat this bread and drink this cup, do not ever forget why I came, to usher in a new Exodus. You know, there's only one hope for the world. It's that you love God, love your neighbor, and love yourself. That's it. It's the only hope there is. You know, back in the 19th century, people were all excited about thinking about the return of Jesus, and there were three different views: the premillennial view, the amillennial view, and the postmillennial view. We'll be preaching about all three of those. Let me think. Never. Really doesn't much matter. But I really did like the postmillennial view, something you never hear any longer. What was that view? That view said that the people of God would love so well that the world would get better and better and better, until eventually Jesus would come. And people would be so happy to have him this time that they would hear his message of love and he would reign for 1,000 years. I don't believe for a minute that in my lifetime I'm going to see a world where love reigns for 1,000 years. But call me foolish enough to believe the day will come if we, this church, we, our nation, we, this species, will learn to love the planet and the God who created it, to love our neighbors, every last one of them, and to love ourselves. Someday, God, someday, may we learn to love. And may we create the world you wanted to create with the Exodus. For this is our prayer, and we pray it in the name of Christ, the new Exodus. Amen.
Justice dawn.
Someday soon, and you and I together, friends, we are working towards that day as Left Hand Community Church. We are working together to bring about that day of justice dawning. Certainly, one of the significant ways we can participate in that work and this ministry is with our offerings. So there are a variety of ways to do that. You can open another tab and go to lefthandchurch.org/give. Set up a recurring gift so that we can scheme our dreams, if you will. Or right now, if you'd like to text a one-time donation of any amount, you can text that to the number 84321 or utilize paypal.me/lefthandchurch if that works for you. during this time of Lent, in this Lenten season, we are making a communal effort to each give up a habit that keeps us from love, giving up a habit that keeps us from loving God, neighbor, or ourselves. And in the process, as a community, we're collecting a gift to help Middle Collegiate Church rebuild after their devastating sanctuary fire and to support our racial justice community partner, the Black Lives Matter Freedom School. So we hope that you might participate in that way as you are so moved. So again, check out all those options at lefthandchurch.org/give. And thank you so much for being an incredible community of generosity and love, and loving ourselves in our growth edges too. It's so good. It's all so good. Nice to see you. Welcome back.
Yeah, good to see you too. Yeah, thanks. That was really beautiful. I was like, don't cry. Don't cry. You'll have to wipe your nose with your mask. That was really good.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. And the sermon was really beautiful too, Paula. Thank you so much.
Right.
Welcome. My name is Christy. My pronouns are she and her. And I welcome you to this time where we share communion together. So if you would gather whatever elements that you have and join us for communion, that would be wonderful. So God is always turning things upside down on us. Greatest is least. Lose your life to gain it. Last will be first. Caring about the least of these. It seems when it comes to power struggles, God is not interested in our human determinations about who deserves anything. As soon as we decide to pick favorites, God subverts our arrogant ordering and picks the opposite. But God is setting things right, dismantling our human pecking orders, welcoming the outcast, giving hope to the poor, washing feet. God is subverting our expectations with a prodigal love that won't quit. Of course, the ultimate expression of God's subversive love is through God's coming to be one of us in the person of Jesus. Through Jesus, God embodied the most excellent way of love, love so selfless and complete that Jesus endured suffering and death, love so powerful that Jesus rose victorious over death itself. We are called to serve the least of these, and in doing so, serve Jesus. As we come to this table, let us remember that we are called to help the poor and oppressed, bring good news to the captives, love children, welcome the outcast, and show God's love in word and deed to everyone everywhere. We are called to live in such a way that we are Jesus to others, that they will know we belong to Jesus because of our love. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he sat in a room among his disciples to celebrate the annual Passover feast. He took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Take, eat, and remember me." Later that same evening, he took the cup. He held it up, saying, "This wine is the blood of a new covenant, a promise for the redemption of all people. Take, drink, and remember me." Take whatever elements you have, remembering that this is Christ's body broken for you and Christ's blood shed for you. Please pray with me. Gracious and loving God, who has created us in your own image, grant us grace to fearlessly contend against evil and to make no peace with oppression. Help us to reverently use our freedom to employ justice in our communities and help us love each other well in the process. Thank you for all the ways you love and guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Spoken and every truth be told. May every promise be unbroken and every gift turn into gold. Let there be mercy, mercy, mercy. Let there be mercy, mercy, mercy. May every curse be broken and every hope revealed. May every blessing be unbroken and every broken heart be healed. Let there be mercy, mercy, mercy. Let there be mercy, mercy, mercy. Let the water flow, let the light shine. Let the blood go through me like a river winds. Through the valley, through the meadow. Let my spirit and my soul, just like a river goes. Through the mountain, under the moonlight. Let the blood go through me till I truly see the light. Let there be mercy, Lord. Let there be mercy, Lord. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Forgive us all the things we've done. Leave the writing on the wall, but don't let it fall, don't let it fall. Let there be mercy, mercy, mercy. Let there be mercy, mercy, mercy. Let there be mercy for my brother and sister, my mother, my family. Let there be mercy for my friends and lovers, foes and enemies. Let there be mercy for my words and words, deeds and deeds I didn't do. Let there be mercy for every soul in the city. May the Lord have pity over you. Let the water flow, let the light shine. Let the blood go through me like a river winds. Through the valley, through the meadow. Through my spirit and my soul, just like a river goes. Over the mountain, under the moonlight. Let the blood go through me till I truly see the light. Let there be mercy, Lord. Oh, let there be mercy, ship. Let us sing a song. Let the spirit on the face of the water be the wind in the sail that carries us home. Hey, Nicole.
Hey there.
Good to see you. How's it going?
Good. Beautiful weather here. I feel like we all got a little preview of spring.
Yeah, it does feel like a little bit of a release and a little bit of a relief to have some sun shining into our lives.
It definitely does.
So I hope people around the country are feeling that.
Yeah, I hope so too.
Yeah.
All right, well, I just have a few announcements for us tonight. The first is that we are underway with our March book study. The selection is No House to Call My Home by Ryan Berg. And it's focused on homelessness and LGBTQ plus youth. It's a wonderful and immersive book. I think it'll provoke some really great discussion. We're going to read independently through the month. We're posting weekly discussion questions in our community group. Many thanks to Kathy Thompson for helping with those questions. Please feel free to jump in and discuss there, even if you haven't quite got to that part of the book yet. We would just love to hear your thoughts. And then we'll meet on March 25th at 6 p.m. over Zoom, and we'll have online discussion then. And then we've got game night coming up this Friday, March 12th, hosted by Christy Sykes. And we've been doing these once a month through the winter. We've got two left. this one and the one in April hosted by Andrea Alvarado. So we hope you'll join us for a night of just fun and fellowship. We also have a virtual branch meeting coming up on Sunday, March 21st at 3:45 p.m. for about the hour before service. If you're not local to Boulder County, or you just would like some virtual fellowship in this time, we encourage you to try out this small group. They meet monthly. You can join the group and get the Zoom link for the March 21st meeting and a link that Julie is going to post for us in the comments. Thank you, Julie. And then we also have our exciting outdoor Easter morning service planned for Easter Sunday, April 4th. At 11:15 a.m., we are going to gather on the front lawn of the UCC Church just adjacent to our beautiful left-hand chapel, and we will also have an Easter egg hunt just before it at 11 o'clock for our littlest left-handers. Many thanks to our co-children's ministers, Brittany and Megan, for organizing that. So we encourage you to wear your masks, throw on an Easter hat if you want to, and we'll gather a lot like we did on Christmas Eve with social distance and just have a morning of celebrating Easter together. And lastly, we hope you'll join us right after the service for our back of church chat, which is about a half an hour of socializing and sermon follow-up. And this was a good one, so I imagine many people will come to talk with Paula about that. The link is going to be in the comments, and we'll hope to see you there.
Fabulous. What a vibrant community. I can't wait to see what happens when we can actually be in the same place together. It's going to be going to just rock our socks.
For sure.
Mm-hmm. All right, friends. As we go on our ways tonight, let's sing together this beautiful invitation to you and to me to come and to go, to breathe in and out love exactly as we are, wherever we are. This beautiful call and invitation based on a story that Christ gave us. Let this fill our bones, our hearts, our mouths. Let's be this kind of people. Face with shame.
gather the unlikely, ignored and left behind. Gather together everyone you find. Go now, go without delay. Go now, there's no time for you to stay here. Go now, go beyond the crowd. Go now, go without delay.
Right with you. Go be love in all of the places where there is unloveliness. Go be love to all whom crave love and do not yet know how lovable they really are, created in the image of God, redeemed recipients of great mercy and life. Let's go be this. Let's go see it and receive it and demonstrate it wherever we go, actually with our feet or virtually online. Go now, beloved, in peace, with peace, create it. Let's go to love God, ourselves, and our neighbor. Amen. There's no time for you.